life's eternal glamour. I'm Anabella de Corro, and here to share my wonderful story with all of you people. All the young people who want to know about the Love Generation, all the people in their 30s and 40s that are interested in our music, the music of the 70s, 80s, and 90s, and of course, all the people that are in their 50s and 60s that actually lived this wonderful time. You know, I, at a very young age, became a rock and roll muse without even wanting to. At the age of 14 and a half here in Las Vegas, I met Eric Burdon of the Animals. At that time, he was bringing on a band called War. He was introducing War to the world, and he was on a world tour, and it was happened to be my first rock and roll concert I was allowed to go to, I was standing around the front row, and I got tapped on the shoulder by Hilton Valentine, which is the original lead guitarist of the Animals, the guy who plays that lick of the House of the Rising Sun. Well, he was then at that time the roadie of Eric Burdon and War. And he tapped me on the shoulder and said, Eric Burdon would like to meet you. And I was a very young girl of 14 and a half, and that kind of intimidated me a little. I was kind of like saying, oh my God, he wants to meet me? I'm a virgin. This is my first concert, and I have a curfew at 10 o'clock. So at that point, I actually had the courage to go backstage with my best friend and meet Eric. And you know, the moment he walked up to me, he said to me, thank you so much for coming backstage. I really wanted to meet you. And he said to me that he had been somewhere in the world and someone had drawn a face that looked like mine, and that I was the face. Well, for me, that was a little intimidating because I was young, innocent, and what did I know about love, sex, and rock and roll? Well, he started to groom me. Let's just say he started to call me. He asked me for my phone number. And as he left to go to the airport, I sat and waited while his chauffeur came back to take us home. And here we were, two innocent girls in our late, well, in our late 14s. We were about to turn 15. And he sent the chauffeur back to take us home. But he called me as I sat in the dressing room and said, by the way, I can't believe I've met you, and if it's okay with you, I would like to call you and get to know you better. Well, believe me, for me that was quite a challenge because here I'd been a wallflower all my life in school. You know, when I would go to a school dance, no one would ask me to dance. But here, this well-seasoned rock star fell head over heels for me and decided to pursue me. Eric started to call me and call me and call me and call me. Whenever he traveled the world, he would give me a call. And when Hendrix passed away, Eric happened to be one of the last people to spend an evening with him. And he called me out of the blue from Germany. At this stage, I was about 15 years old, and he told me that Hendrix had passed and that he was very depressed. But that the only light that he had in his heart is that he was looking forward to coming back to California, which is where he was living. He was living in Laurel Canyon, and that he was looking forward to seeing me again. And he did claim at one point that I saved his life because he fell into a very deep depression that this great brother of his, Jimi Hendrix, was gone. Well, interesting, that song, Spill the Wine and Take the Pearl, was kind of inspired on our relationship because most people don't know that Spill the Wine and Take the Pearl means a man who spills the semen and he takes a girl's virginity. That's what the song is about. In November of 1969, it was an announcement on the rock station that Eric Burdon and War would be coming to Las Vegas at a famous venue called the Ice Palace. Well, this is what's interesting. In YouTube, there's a rare Spill the Wine 1977 where Eric is singing Spill the Wine and Take the Pearl in a live concert, and he goes into a rap about touring the world and ending up in Las Vegas at the Ice Palace and meeting the Ice Queen.
I was out spinning around the world one century, and I have to stop at a place called Las Vegas, Nevada. It's in the U.S. of A.A. And I did this gig in a place called the Ice Palace. It was there I met the Ice Queen. She saw right through me and where I was going, where I'd been. And I said, baby, I got to take you home with me. She said, baby, it's gonna cost you. Things like me don't just come free. You got to bring up a...
Imagine calling me the Ice Queen. I was 14 and a half. What did I know about love, sex, and rock and roll?
In our hand was a bottle of red wine, in the other a glass. She poured some of the wine from the bottom of the glass, raised it to her lips, looking dead in the eye. And just before she drank it, she said,
this last Friday, I was with Eric, and it was great to see him. I hadn't seen him in about 20 years. And I was able to go after the show, of course, backstage and say hello. And he was very impressed when he saw me. He was like, is that you, Annabelle? Is that you? And I sat there and I said, yes, it is me. And I thought I would come and give you a few pages of what I've written about my time with you since I was your muse. And you know what he said to me? He said to me, that time I spent with you was some of the greatest time of my life. And yes, it was. So I have decided to write a memoir, a book of my life, about how I became a rock and roll muse and the first Mexican Vogue model. I'm looking for funding because I want it to be a beautiful book. I just don't want it to be just kind of like a self-published little cheap version of a book, because I worked very hard on this. I had some help on the book. I actually had a ghostwriter help me with some of this work. And it's amazing. They say that if you were in the 60s and the 70s, if you remember them, you weren't there. Well, I remembered everything. Amazing. We did take the mind-expanding drugs. But guess what? I remember everything. And I say, I was kind of like a Matthew, that I had this memory to remember what Eric said to me, what he shared with other people. And after about a year and a half, he showed up in Las Vegas with his attorney, and he came and asked for my hand to my parents. And he convinced my parents that he would give me a great life, and we would travel the world, and he would sit there and groom me and make me a model or definitely inspire. And in the book, I absolutely am very flattering to Eric. Of course, I talk about how he broke my heart. And I felt to a degree that I'd been used and abused by him, because I was innocent. I didn't know about money and about suing people or doing anything like that, or simply making him follow through what he had promised my parents to do for me. Well, in the book that I am writing, Life's Eternal Glamour, I share all of this wonderful history. And so this book is historical, it's wonderful, it's about sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and all you young people are gonna love it. You're gonna love it. And you're gonna see why we, my generation, changed the world.